to this edition of Ask a Death Doula. My name is Suzanne O'Brien. You're going to love today's show. I am inspired by our guest on so many levels. So this is Dr. Karen Wyatt. She is a best-selling author of the books The Tao of Death and Seven Lessons for Living from the Dying. This book contains stories of patients she's cared for as a hospice doctor and the spiritual lessons she learned from them at the end of their lives. Dr. Wyatt also hosts End of Life University podcast, which is amazing, and it features conversations with experts who work in all aspects of end of life care. She is widely regarded as a thought leader in the effort to transform the way we care for our dying in the US. In addition, she is valued for her application of spiritual principles to illness and healthcare, and teaches that in order to live and love life fully, we must each overcome our fear of death and embrace the difficulties that life brings us. Welcome, Dr. Karen Wyatt.
Thank you, Suzanne. It's such a pleasure to be with you.
It is wonderful to have you here. You are, again, somebody who I've looked up to and just watched the incredible work that you do for this movement for years now. So there's so much we want to talk about, but first I just want to share a little bit from you about your background and what brought you to this incredible place of being, again, a thought leader in the end-of-life space.
Well, I started out in medicine as a family practice doctor. So I had my own clinic seeing family practice patients. And about 3 years into that, a tragedy struck my family when my father died by suicide. And it was absolutely devastating to me, of course, as his daughter, but also as a doctor, because I went to medicine with a belief in love, and that love heals anything and everything, which was a little bit unusual in medicine in that day to have that belief system. And I'd been trained to do behavioral health and to work with patients with depression. And so the fact that I couldn't save my own father, a person I loved more than anything, with my training, with all my love and all my knowledge, I couldn't save him from suicide. It really destroyed me. And so I floundered in grief and guilt for a number of years. And finally, I got the inspiration that maybe I should try volunteering in hospice, because I thought maybe I need to know more about death. I need to understand it. And I need to understand my own grief and what was happening to me. So I became a volunteer as a medical director, as a volunteer for a hospice. Absolutely fell in love with that work. The first time I visited a patient in their home, I knew in my heart, this is where I was supposed to be all along. This is the work I was supposed to be doing. And so I ended up ultimately becoming a full-time hospice director. And it was just the best work I ever could have been involved in. And so I got inspired during those years of working with hospice patients, though, to write a book one day. And so I knew for a number of years, eventually I would write some of the stories and the lessons that I was learning from the patients.
So incredible. That is so incredible. Thank you for that. And it's so interesting how what you say about how you felt about hospice and when you went there your first day almost mirrors exactly how I felt. I've never felt more alive until I started working in end of life, which people can't really understand until we start sharing what that means. And I think it's so beautiful that, again, you turn something that was like beyond painful, you know, I just can't even imagine, into, you know, listening and following what you needed to do and going into that and understanding that space of end of life, and then this whole blossoming of, you know, your journey from that step forward. What an honor to your dad.
Yeah, it's funny. When I originally wrote, I mean, the book that's coming out now is a new version of the original book I wrote 10 years ago. But when my first copy of that book arrived in the mail, I opened the package and said, "Look what we did, Dad." Ah. And those are the words that came from my mouth. And I realized my dad had been my silent partner all along through all of this work. And that you know, I wouldn't be here without the role my dad played in shifting me dramatically onto a new career path. So
absolutely. And I feel like that is something that we're going to talk about when we talk about the book, is that the experiences we have, even the painful ones, sometimes the most painful ones, are our greatest gifts on how we can transform and learn and move forward. So I appreciate every experience that I've had, everyone that's been a part of that, whether again, it presented as a negative perceived one or positive. But what an honor to, you almost had me crying here on the podcast. What a beautiful thing to say. And it's so true that your dad is such a wonderful teacher in all of this. Yes. So let's talk about when you got to hospice, and we love hospice. Hospice is one of the most beautiful models of care. We're really challenged in end of life in our world right now. You know, I used to say our country, United States, but it's really global because so many things are westernized. And even though we both felt so at peace and connected to being in that hospice space, I think we both saw that there were gaps with this whole association with death being a part of the journey of life with patients and with the whole system. So can you speak to that a bit, please?
Yes. Even when I was in hospice, one thing I observed was feeling estranged somewhat from the rest of the medical profession. Mm-hmm. When I would go to medical meetings and talk about the fact that I'm doing hospice now, being treated as if, well, that's not really medicine. You're not really a doctor. I mean, we're supposed to be keeping people from dying, and so I definitely felt that a gap there in perception of what hospice does. And particularly, I think in some ways within hospice, I was in a bit of a bubble because, you know, when you do this work day in and day out every day, mm-hmm. and are so entrenched in it, I didn't realize how resistant our society was to, until I wrote a book actually, and then started trying to talk to people about it. And then I discovered no one wants to hear about this whatsoever. I was a little bit shocked because all of the patients and their families who were in hospice were open to it. So I was a little oblivious to how resistant the rest of our society was to talking about death and dying.
Yeah, I agree with you. So let's go back to our doctors for a minute, because I think we have to really understand this. It's super important to know that there are a few of the variables as why we are so disconnected and have a dysfunctional relationship with end of life. And one of them is that we've told our doctors in the last 80 to 100 years, we've taught them how to fix it. We've said, and we've made huge medical advances, this is how you keep somebody alive. And we can keep people alive for a very long time, but being alive and living are two very different things. And we haven't given them the tools or the permission to know that end of life is a natural part of the patient's journey. But not only that, that there is so much that they can do in that space to support that person and family. So for me, because my background is oncology nurse and hospice nurse, when my doctors had an end of life experience with their patient, even if it was somebody who was 99, they literally felt like they failed. And I thought, what have we done with this messaging?
Oh, it's really mm-hmm. tragic actually, mm-hmm. because I think one of the reasons a lot of doctors are burning out right now is because they do feel like they've failed when a death happens, and because they haven't been able to embrace the full spectrum of life from birth through death, and see that, you know, there's only so much we can do. And there comes a time when it is the normal process for a person to be dying. And if they could embrace that and not take it on as some personal mission to prevent that from happening.
Which is 100%. It's impossible to do that.
It's impossible. It's such a setup. And they find it so gratifying and beautiful if they could be part of that experience.
Absolutely. So we love our doctors. You know, we look up to our doctors. We listen to our doctors. And if we could, again, bring them into this space of having this be a natural part of the journey for us, not a failure. And yet there's so much they can do, because as we both know, holistically and close symptom management and just bearing witness to somebody who's going through that, holding that space for them, is like the best medicine that we have. So on so many levels, I think as a society, we have to really look at what we've done to our doctors and medical system, because you're right, they're burning out for not only that, but like for the reason that they have to see a million people and all of that. Very, very important. So I think we really have to do our work in that space. And then you said another thing about when you got to hospice, and it is, it's the most beautiful energy and love and connection. And then when you go outside to share that with people, they're like, oh, you know, we don't want to talk about that. And I was the same way. I grew up in a medical family who was very open about illness. You know, I've heard about it since I was a child. So I knew that everyone wasn't really talking about it, but I sure didn't know that it was as backwards as it was. And I felt the same way. I thought, my gosh, what are we going to do here? Because that denial is leading to very challenging end of life.
Exactly. And I believe it's medical professionals who should be leading the way for their patients. They should be educating their patients all along and helping their patients face up to the fact that we can't fix everything. It's beyond us. It's not even meant to be that we could fix everything. So I will work with you. We're a team. We'll work together as much as we can, but there will be a day when we have to accept what comes and what happens, and I'll still be on your team when that day comes.
Exactly. I love that. So I've often thought that our language that we're using within the medical system is, again, really, we have to be careful. You know, I'm sorry, there's no more I can do for you. Lost our battle with, we have to look at that. There's so much we can do. But I agree with you that I thought on wellness visits and on your annual visit, the doctor should say, and remember, there's going to come a day when we shift our focus from, you know, I don't like the word aggressive either, but with like, you know, extending or whatever they want to do to close symptom supportive management. That sounds really nice to me. I'm like, oh, somebody's going to really watch me. So when I come in there one day and she says, do you remember the time that we kept talking about one day? Today's the day. And what we're going to do is we're going to do this whole program of close symptom management. It should really be this kind of natural thing that we all anticipate ahead of time.
Yes, far ahead of time. Yeah. I have a friend who's an emergency room doctor who told me she draws for patients a map, and she calls it the map of life. And it starts with birth and it ends with death. Mm-hmm. And she said, you have to understand that you're on this journey, you're on this trajectory, but someday you're going to be on this side of the map. And so you have to know that and be prepared for that. And it's like, that's brilliant. That's how simple it is. Just tell people.
And I think that that leads us a great segue into your book, because life is a journey. And there are so many things, again, that you and I have talked about listening to the wisdom. I call it, they get their spiritual eyes. You know, these beautiful end of life patients who share their perspective. Again, looking back at the whole life's journey, and we all have ups and downs, and we all have things that happen. And I believe that all of them are perfectly synchronized for each individual that we're supposed to have these. So again, when we look at that whole map that you just talked about from that doctor, it's so simple and so beautiful. And I think what your message in this book is exactly the same, to share with people that there are ups and downs, there's going to be difficulties, and where do you find your strength, and what are those universal laws that we all have globally? Because if we can get back to those foundations, we're going to see our world heal. So let's talk about your book. What was, again, the moment that you decided, I need to put pen to paper, I need to do this, and how did that come about?
Well, I was talking with one of our patients one day who was, he had been a very successful banker and had lots and lots of money, many, many material possessions, very successful in his life, but was miserable in life because he was estranged from his wife and son, lived alone. And as he was going through the dying process, he was recognizing, what have I done with my life? And one day he said, I just figured out what really matters in life, and it is love. And he said, but I waited too long to the very end. And he said, not only have I wasted the love that I had in my life, but he said, now I don't even have enough time to tell other people what I've learned. And then he looked at me and he said, would you write my story one day? Would you tell people what I've learned? And in that moment, I thought, that is what I'm supposed to do. I'm gathering all these stories that our patients don't have the voice or the time to teach everyone what they know. But if I could speak for them and put their stories in words, at least I could honor them and honor all the teachings that I gained from them.
That's so beautiful, Karen. And I think that, again, you know, death is the second leading fear in the United States and plenty of other places. I think it bumped up to number one since the pandemic happened.
Yes.
Okay. And public speaking's number two. So we just share that. People have not seen end of life, you know, really in the last 60, 80 years because we've kind of outsourced our elderly, which, again, we're talking about one of the greatest tools on how to live our life correctly with this wonderful wisdom from this gentleman who shared that. And we've literally pushed that resource away. Not only that, but from an ethical, moral standpoint, just the way we're caring for people or not caring for our elderly properly, that we really have to take a look at this on many levels. But I think that, again, for you and I and people who've been privileged to be in that space working at the bedside with end-of-life patients to share those bedside experiences and exactly the message that you're sharing really helps people to say, wait a minute, maybe I shouldn't be afraid and maybe I should listen to this gentleman. Because for me, I always say that, you know, they're not trying to sell you anything. They have nothing to gain by, you know, there's no motive there other than pure heart-centered connection.
Yes. And for me, one thing that was so powerful, having come into hospice with carrying this huge burden of grief and guilt over my dad's death, I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't know how to make that fit into my life. And recognizing from watching them and how gracefully they carried having a terminal illness and approaching death very rapidly, that's when it suddenly became clear to me that, oh, wait, this pain is just a part of life. This is all contained within a normal, natural, happy, wonderful, beautiful life. And even the pain that I was feeling, I suddenly realized it belongs here. It belongs in my life. I'm trying to get rid of it, and it belongs in my life because it's teaching me things and it's helping me be a better person.
And you can transmute that energy into that productive way of healing. So beautiful. That is absolutely incredible. Yeah, it's like our end of life patients and our teachers on so many powerful levels. I remember coming out of an oncology room because I had seven patients at one time, and it was just and again most end of lives are not going as well as they could go. Let's just put it that way. And I remember walking out of this room where this person was dying, and just the family surrounding them, just it happened organically. And the energy in that room, you know, this is in my younger years. And I literally came out and I was so moved by the beauty and love. And I said, if people knew about that, if they knew end of life could be like that, they would never be afraid of it. So this is so important for us to talk about.
Oh, yes, absolutely. There were so many times that I felt that same power. Mm-hmm. It was the power of love and forgiveness, all of which become possible more than ever during those last months and days of life.
Yeah.
And the beauty of it. And it happens rapidly. I was thinking of families who sometimes have been carrying resentment toward one another for 20 years. Suddenly it's like instantaneous almost. You can see them heal before your very eyes and see them forgive one another and reunite. It's amazing, but it's a wonderful gift that most people don't realize is available to us.
Right, exactly. So we want to share with them what that they can do now to capitalize on their lives. So what I also noticed is that there were so many recurring things that end-of-life patients will say about the awareness and the journey in different countries, different cultures, which really was like fascinating. And it's interesting you say it's almost like for 20, 30 years of holding on to grudges, and it almost happens like instantly or rapidly. And my theory on that is that I feel like their spiritual part of their being is growing as they get closer to that end of life, allowing for this diffusal of the ego and the anger and more love to come so that they can. But when you see that transformation of forgiveness, it's like, why didn't we do that 20 years ago?
Exactly. I have had a number of patients say that to me, like, yeah. Oh my gosh, like this feels amazing. You mean I could have been free of all of that anger and negativity for all these years. That's the other thing that compelled me to want to write about
it.
And that's something that changed for me dramatically, because I realized I could actually start working on forgiveness every day right now and try to let go of some of those burdens and not carry it with me over the years.
Yeah. So we're going to get into your book and some of the lessons for sure. And just let's hold on to forgiveness for a minute, because I think again that this is part of the journey, and people have to realize that there's forgiveness of others and there's forgiveness of ourself. And those are two different things. And the universal law of non-judgment. So, because this is what patients will say at the end, there's no judgment. We're all connected to one unconditional loving energy. That means you too. So when you want to step into your forgiveness, we really don't have the right to judge other people, nor do we have the right to be judged. So it's a beautiful, beautiful bubble to be in when you're going to start to work those steps. Yeah. So let's talk about this book. Tell me about this new book. And I know it's the 7 lessons, and just tell me about, again, the premise for it, and then we're going to share some of the stories.
Okay. Here it is.
Yay! I'll just show it. We're going to put it all.
I have
beautiful.
One copy. The printers aren't working right now because of the pandemic, so it's only available in ebook, but I got one copy before everything shut down.
Yay! Okay.
Well, so over time, as I gathered all these stories from my patients, it occurred to me that I was really learning like universal ancient wisdom, that what was happening is that they were learning this ancient wisdom that had been taught by spiritual teachers for centuries. But they were learning it in modern day times in the way that they could grasp the lessons. And so it propelled me to learn a little bit more, to start studying more wisdom texts from the past and learn spiritual wisdom, and gradually these lessons began to coalesce, the 7 lessons that I saw people working on and that I became aware of in my own life that I needed to work on as well, and needed to go through my own process of learning about this spiritual wisdom. So that over time it became clearer and clearer that the way what I was learning from my patients were these 7 different lessons. And I don't know if you want me to talk about.
Sure, please. If you could share some of them. Yeah.
The first, I think the thing that I started learning initially was about suffering in general. And that included my guilt and grief that I was trying to understand in my life, and just making room in our lives for difficulties and pain and suffering, and knowing that that will always come. It's part of life, and it's actually suffering is one of our greatest teachers. Therefore, we shouldn't wish it away. And yet we live in a society that it's all about pleasure and joy and buying more things and having more fun experiences and resisting the difficulties that come along. Of course, one thing about this pandemic is that it took a lot of our options away. We're all sitting here, you know, with a lot fewer options for how do we continually find pleasures in life.
Right.
We're reduced down to the very basics of life, getting up and making a cup of coffee in the morning. And, you know, I think that's been a really good thing for us. But for me, I needed to embrace that, because I said that I was practicing medicine from the aspect of love, and that love is what would heal patients. But because I was young and naive at that time, I thought that love could make suffering go away. And I didn't understand that suffering is part of love, and they come together and part of life. That's what I was learning at that time. Yeah. And once I figured that out, I could go back to the next lesson, which is love and the power of love to transform.
I want to stay with suffering for a minute, because I think this is so important that people get this, because we're living in such a time in our lives that there's so much suffering, and we witness on the news. And so again, we've talked again about love and fear being really the two energies that are out there. But let's talk about the suffering for a second and the ability for it to bring about an accelerated spiritual growth or a lesson learned. Because if we can change our perception of the pain and suffering and know, and I think it's so important that what you said is that it's a part of the journey. It's included in all of our journeys. We just sort of, it shows up in different ways at different times for all of us, but everyone has it. And to make friends with it.
It's, yes.
Yeah. And I also think, again, from being a practitioner, I think that you can relate to this, is that we're not here to fix it for people. We're not supposed to take it away, even though we want to, like initially, of course you want people, but to bear witness and have that compassion and empathy is so incredibly powerful and healing while they're going through their journey.
Yes, absolutely. And I think to go back to our earlier point about Western medical practitioners are not trained to be present with suffering, to embrace suffering, and to see it as a valuable part of the journey. They're trained to try to eliminate suffering. And that's, so we go astray right from the very beginning,
right.
And also encourage our patients to go down that path as well.
Yeah, it's like suffering is a indication that there is something that needs to be, you know, shifted, whatever that is. And pain is also, and so first of all, our doctors don't have the time to really, again, bear witness. But when we're covering up all the symptoms as a Western society doing what we do with medical, we're not getting to the root of where that pain is originating from. And when we can get to the root and the seed and transform it, for that, then it can go away and transmute. But we don't give anyone the opportunity because we're quickly just putting Band-Aids on stuff.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
So beautiful. So we talked about the suffering. So let's talk about love, because I gotta tell you, it's all there is and it's everything. And it really is the key. And I think if people understand, again, I think it's very helpful that there's no judgment, that this is, we're all part of this journey with all of it in order to learn to love unconditionally. So can you speak to that? Because I love that you came into medicine with love was going to be your medicine to heal. And it actually is, Karen. I know you had to go through the whole thing, but it is.
Yeah. Well, I had that inspiration when I was 16.
Beautiful.
And so from then on, I kind of understood my purpose is to learn about love, and medicine will be my career. And that's how I will learn about love, and I'll bring love to my medical practice. So, but that was a very unusual way
yes.
of the world for a 16-year-old. And I did fine. It was when once I got into medical school, and I tried talking about that idea at the very beginning of medical school and realized everyone thought I was completely crazy and off the wall for the things I was saying. So I knew right away, like, this doesn't fit here. So I suddenly knew, okay, I have to get into just this rational scientific mode and look at all the science and not tell people what I know. But even as a medical student, I would go back and spend extra time with patients because mm-hmm. I just felt it. I felt like they need me. They need to spend more time telling their story, not just answering this checklist of questions that I'm going through, you know, in the review of systems. And so I would go back and spend more time with patients. I was trying to cultivate that sense of love, of sharing love back and forth with patients as a student. But I was all on my own in that. There was no support, of course, for that whatsoever.
Yeah. But I think what's happening now, there's so many gifts, obviously, which is hard to, again, even when I say it, you know, I'm thinking of everything that's going on and I'm saying, how could you say there are gifts? You know, but there are. And I think one of the things that really, it's like a pot of boiling water that's just going to the top, and it's really forcing us to take a look at what's important and get rid of the stuff and really, again, come to, and I think this love concept is being embraced on one side within all different aspects of the world, because that's the truth. Yeah.
Yes. And as we're going through some suffering together as an entire planet, I think love keeps rising to the surface over and over and over again. There aren't any other answers. There isn't anything else to do. And suddenly people start to recognize that, oh, maybe I'll just show kindness to my neighbors. That's all that we're able to do right now. So in a way it's perfect for this process of trying to learn to love more. I can say, even though I started at 16, I've spent my whole life still learning about love, still learning more, still discovering more about how to love myself better so that I can love other people better. Seeing all the ways in which I don't love, all the times when I'm not as loving as I would like to think I am. And so it's infinite. There's so much to learn.
Absolutely. And not to beat yourself up about that. The awareness is the first step. But I love when you said that right now, all we can offer one another basically is our kindness and that's all we can offer. But that might be the most powerful thing we could ever give each other. You know, I live in New York City and I live on a beautiful block and I'm meeting so many people just in a passing of the clap at 7 o'clock or walking my dog from a distance that are really seeing each other. You know, people that have lived here for years, I'm finally getting to meet because everyone was just doing their own thing, blindlessly going through it. This is the richness. And also, what about the kindness to the planet and kindness to animals? You know, bring it back to those basics. So beautiful your messaging. And I think your time has definitely come with the love as medicine. So let's talk about another lesson from the book.
Well, the next lesson in the book is forgiveness, which we talked about already, but I see it as really a component of love because the more we love, the more we're pulled to recognize, oh, well, then I have to forgive. If I love unconditionally, I cannot hold on to these resentments. So like that this other person, I may have been hurt, but I understand I still love that person and I understand no one's perfect. And so they really come together. As soon as you start to embrace love, the need to forgive people
for sure
comes up. And so they go hand in hand.
Go ahead.
I would say that was probably the most universal lesson I saw with all of my patients. Everyone at the end of life was talking about how do I forgive someone or how do I feel forgiven and forgiven.
Yes, 1,000%. So the people who I have been privileged again to see that forgiveness be, and it's most, and hopefully all people, but again, when I've seen the forgiveness play a role in that end of life, the transformation of energy has been just almost, you can't describe it. The love, the release, the joy. It's just, and we can do this today, you and I. And it's on a daily, we have to small and big and all of those things. So I love that you have highlighted that for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, and the next lesson that kind of grew from that was learning how to be in the present moment. And I discovered that forgiveness is key for that as well, because if we don't forgive, we stay stuck in the past. We keep reliving something that happened a long time ago and nurturing all of our anger and hurt feelings and resentment instead of just here, living here right now, seeing what's in front of us.
And I think people have to understand that forgiveness is for you. It's not about the other person at all. It's about you. So I kind of share with people that unforgiveness is like having a backpack with 40-pound weights and you're going uphill all of the time. You know, it's draining your energy to let that go. And it's so important for you. And again, coming from the place of love is that everyone is doing their best. And it's so ironic to me that sometimes people who you've had an issue with and you're holding on to anger for 30 years ago have no idea what you're talking about.
It's so true. I hear this all the time. People say, well, if I forgive that person, then I'm letting them off the hook. It's like you assume that your resentment has power over them. It doesn't. It doesn't.
Just over you.
just over you. They're in their own world. They're on their own path. They're dealing with their own suffering and their own issues. And you are, it's not your job to punish someone. And you're only punishing yourself if you believe that you are punishing someone else.
Right. And I also think there is a lesson for all of us in every single thing that we experience. So for me, from, again, a loving place, what can I learn from that experience? So in addition to giving forgiveness, is there a lesson there for me to learn? Maybe it's how I never want to act, that I don't want to ever act like that person acted towards anyone else, you know, whatever it may be. Yeah, but compassion and love, yeah, very important. So beautiful. Okay, another lesson that you want to share?
So we talked about just being in the present moment. Which
that's super important, right?
Has been one of the biggest gifts for me that I'm still working on, remembering to be where I am and notice where I am instead of thinking about the future or staying stuck in the past. I think it's huge. That was something, and so many times I was in awe of my patients as I watched how they enjoyed every single moment of their last weeks of life, and they didn't want to waste anything. So when they were with a loved one, they were truly present and truly listening and sharing and or watching the sunset or eating an ice cream cone. And it was clear to me that I didn't live that way at all at that time. I was never really in the present moment, never fully enjoying what was happening right now. So that's been a huge lesson for me.
Okay, so people need to hear this for sure, because this is it. So the present moment is the perfect moment, and it's all we truly know. So if we're living in the past, which again, our world is not living in the present moment, and that's what we're seeing, this complete disconnect of energy. So the past is usually full of regret, resentment, anger. The future is of anxiety and worry, and we're bombarded with things to keep us out of the present moment. So it really is a practice that we need to start bringing back. How do I get the access to this moment? And it's a vibration and an energy. And when you do, and I really want to share this, because I think this is, again, I want you to speak to this. This is a tool that people can use within times of trauma and great stress, which we're all going through globally right now. There have been moments, and I practice these, that I am able to, it's like an access point for me, able to access that present moment fully with some techniques, with meditation, sitting in the sun, creating awareness of my senses, where I have so much joy and bliss within a world that we're living in, which is so full of pain and suffering. I'm not saying that I'm not part of that. I am absolutely part of that. I want to help do whatever I can, and I'm affected. But there are those moments that I'm able to be in that present moment that I don't feel the suffering. And it's a beautiful thing, because I feel so connected.
Yes, yes, definitely. And that's the key to it. Yeah. Because one thing I observed is the more we're in the present moment, it's as if we're stringing together all of these moments and teaching ourselves that actually life is really beautiful. It's full of creativity and love in the present moment. But when my mind wanders off to the future and I'm thinking, oh, what's going to happen? How will things be next week or next month? Or what, you know, when will this change, or what will happen? You spin off into negative emotions and fearful energy. And then there's no room for the love and peace that we want to feel. And one tool that helps me always is to take a deep breath and focus on my breath, because breath is in the present moment. We're breathing in this moment. And when I stop and notice my breath and really focus on breathing in and out, it's like it instantly gets me out of that mental space where I was worrying about everything.
That is beautiful. And another thing that I do that's so easy for me is to sit in nature and just listen, you know, listen to the birds, feel the sun, and just really try and connect with that. It's again, a way for me to instantly access, and listening to your breath is another tool. And this is something that people can do within minutes, and they can use this. And even if you can step into that alignment, what I call alignment, a couple of times a day, it is so grounding and healthy, and you can access it anytime you want.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And it changes everything the moment you get back into the present space. A friend of mine taught me something to say, oh, yes, all of these things could happen. Yes, that could happen. But right now, I'm okay. right now, in this moment, everything's fine. And so I started doing, right now, mm-hmm. I'm okay because the sun's shining and it's a beautiful day. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm okay because I have a roof over my head and I mm-hmm. have plenty of food to eat and I'm making a wonderful dinner tonight that I'm going to enjoy. Mm-hmm. You know, so
yeah.
just that reminder that in this moment where we are right now,
it's perfect.
It's perfect. Everything's
okay. And your cells hear and listen to what you're going to tell them. So if you're going to be in that fear, worry, angry place, they're going to pick that up, your nervous system. And if you say, I'm okay, we're okay. It really does. It's amazing the energy shift that it makes. And again, these are things that people can do within minutes for themselves.
Yes, yes, absolutely. And that's what I would say. I'm still working on trying to be in the present moment as much as possible, full time. I mean, I'd love to be there. I'm not.
Yeah.
But learning, as you were saying, how important it is to be aware and to recognize every time I slip out
yes.
and slip into fearful thinking
yeah.
or regret or anger or something to remind
right.
myself, oh, you don't need to be there. Just be here.
yeah. Loving yourself for that too. And you can bring back. And I think, again, gratitude is one of the quickest ways to energetically shift. And it's such a high vibration. And I've never been so grateful for like the cup of coffee in the morning and the roof over my head. Like every day we start out like that. It's the simple things. And just all the beautiful, great things we're seeing in the world of kindness and compassion, you know, coming together.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Right now, I would say what's helping me the most, I can only take in so much news
yeah.
without counterbalancing that with reading
correct.
About the love and the beauty and the mm-hmm. kindness that's being shown all yes. around the world.
Yes. Yes. And again, the love will always prevail, but it's going to be a process for us all to be on board. And having compassion for people that you don't agree with. This is something really important for us to know because it can be so disturbing, some of the things we're seeing and hearing. And if we come at it with anger, we have to observe it. We have to know what's happening, but we also have to send love to this situation as well, which I know can seem really hard to understand what I'm saying, but that's the only way we're really going to shift it is if we can do that.
It's so true. Even when we see other people who are behaving in a hateful mm-hmm. manner or
yeah.
people we don't agree with, people we don't like,
yeah.
we still need to be able to return to love in our own yeah. hearts because that's the only way we can stay at peace. And it's the only way we can spread peace and love to the rest of the world. We can't descend to that similar
right.
place of anger
right.
and hatred. We have to constantly pull ourselves back to the present moment and to the love that we're capable of feeling right now.
Absolutely. I love that. So let's share another lesson if you'd like. And then again, people are going to want to get this book. And I just want to like talk about the book in general and where they can find it. But do you want to share another one or two lessons that you really want to highlight
okay.
for those of us?
Okay. Well, one was understanding purpose, the purpose of life, because I see so many people who are struggling, wondering like, well, what's my purpose? What will my career path be? What will I be doing for my job?
Uh-huh.
And what came clear to me after sitting with my patients and then looking back at my life experiences too, is that we really have a purpose here that's more spiritual. The purpose of even being here on the planet is mm-hmm. to learn and grow and to mm-hmm. learn about love. And if we embrace mm-hmm. that as our overall purpose, what we do for our career and our job doesn't matter so much. It matters that we pick something that we're good at, that we enjoy, that we feel fulfilled by, but we have an overarching purpose that's way bigger than just the job we do. That helped me so much in medicine to remember, like, I'm here learning about so many, many things besides mm-hmm. medicine. I'll mm-hmm. practice medicine and I'll be doing that, but the medicine I'm practicing is in service of everything else I came here to learn. Mm-hmm. And then it helped me tolerate the ups and downs or when I lost a job and had mm-hmm. to go find another job. It's like, oh, okay, well, I'm done learning at that job. I'll go find a different one. And now
yeah.
I can keep learning what I need to learn there.
Oh, I love that. Because if we really pull back to what I call our highest self and awareness And look at all of this. There is something, again, that's so peaceful within that, because we know the big meaning of learning to love and all being connected and oneness, right? And so that's in all these lessons that we go through. But when we know that there's that bigger picture, all of, again, the daily kind of ups and downs and things don't have the weight that they do. And also, I love that we're all in this together, in this beautiful energetic place. And if you're hurting across the world, I'm hurting. I don't want you to hurt. And I want to bear witness, and I want to send you love and compassion. And the planet and the animals and all of that. I mean, it really is like, you're like what you said, it lose a job, get a job. But every opportunity that you have in life is that bigger mission of sharing love and learning to love in all of it. Beautiful.
Yes. And when you carry that with you,
yeah,
that helps you, that just helps you ride through the ups and downs, mm-hmm, and tolerate all the things that come along in life, and to even have a philosophy of, oh, well, you know what, I'm going to let that go. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm done with that now, and I'm waiting for the next thing, and I will do the best with it. And maybe that's something relevant. You know, lots of people now, right now, are unemployed, yeah, and probably, yes, wondering, what will, yes, I do? What's, yes, coming? But just remember, any job out there is never your full purpose in life. That's not really what you came here for, to do that particular job.
Right.
You're just here. You're here to learn how to love, and you can, yeah, learn it on any other job that comes along.
I love that. And also, there is a internal guidance system that you have. When you, again, are in that present moment alignment, it's very clear your direction, and always honoring that, because it is not something that's analytical. It's a knowing, and that will always bring you to the place that you're supposed to go. And so people will ask me, well, how do I know if I'm, you know, doing the right thing, or if this is the right move for me? And I said, does it feel hard? Does it feel uncomfortable? Are you stressed? Then it's not the right move. You know, when you think of it, if something is flowing and seems easy and connected, like you and I talked about our first day at hospice, it was like the last piece of the puzzle, and like this bright light popped out. That's what you want to follow, the flow. And that goes with people and jobs and everything in your life. I love it.
Yeah, so true.
It's a good gauge. Yeah.
And yet most people are unaware of it. They're unaware. They might feel the spark at times, but they don't know what it means or understand how to follow it. And so,
yeah,
for me, that was another key lesson, mm-hmm, of recognizing, you know, let the jobs come and go. It doesn't, yep, matter. And just be ready for the next thing, whatever is there, and know that I am going to keep learning no matter what happens or what comes.
Gosh, can we teach our children that in school, in elementary school? You know, this is a great opportunity too, to rewrite some of the education system, if not all of it. Because if we teach children the kindness and volunteer and all of these universal laws from day one. And like you said, I love that. Let the jobs come and go. When is the last time we ever heard that? You know what I mean? But it's so, but it's so true, because right now we define everyone by what they look like, what job they have, how big is their house. This is all false. You know, at the beginning, we started today about the goal of life and things of that nature. And so we've literally been set up to shoot for the goals that are all wrong.
It's so true. And then on our deathbeds, we suddenly have clarity and recognize, like, oh, wait, it isn't about any of those things that I thought were important. That's what felt tragic to me, is,
yeah,
can't we come to, yeah, this realization earlier in life?
Yes.
And many of my patients said to me, wow, it would have changed everything if I had understood this before, and wondering how come I didn't know this, because no one was there to teach them.
But you are, and you're here now to do that. And you just gave me chills with the last thing that you said, because it's so true that, you know, their time was at the end, but you are carrying this torch and this gift that can change people's lives, can help them to really, again, find that peace, serenity, and connection that we're all seeking. So Karen, please tell us how we can get this book.
All right. Well, it is being released on May 12th, and it will be on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Google Books, online. It's because right now bookstores are closed in a lot of places.
Yeah.
So not in print yet, but it's available as an ebook for right now. And it's 7 lessons for living from the dying. But people can buy it online. They can even pre-order it before the 12th and get the start with the ebook for right now. The publisher made it a reasonable price, and people can go back and get the print book later if they'd like to have a hard copy of it on hand.
Perfect. Perfect. So I'm going to put the link below so you can click and just go right now and get that ebook. I will tell you that this is everything that I believe in from day one, and wanting to get out and share, you know, these messages from these incredible teachers at the end of life, and putting it all in perspective. Can again, when somebody's at the end of life and they say, I get it now, but my life's over now, we want to share with people because we're all seeking and we all want to be happy, and you can be. So this book is an incredible resource. So are you, Dr. Karen Wyatt. I want to thank you so much for being a guest today on Ask a Death Doula.
Oh, thank you, Suzanne. It's been such a pleasure to talk with you.
Thank you so much. And our work is to be continued. So everyone, you can click the link below, get the book, and we'll see you in the next episode. All right, everybody. See you next time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.